Okay. Hi, guys. Welcome back to our Dole discussion group. I'm CJ Jackson with POLITICO and KU grad. Excited to be back here for our penultimate discussion group on the first 100 days with President Trump. I'm very lucky, again, to be joined by one of my wife's former colleagues at the White House. Caitlin Hayden was a senior spokeswoman for the NSC, National Security Council, career diplomat who's traveled all over the world, and will tell us a little bit about that. But today we're going to focus our discussion on President Trump's diplomatic efforts and kind of how new administrations form their diplomatic approach, and also kind of what is unique about this administration's approach to diplomacy, and what is pretty what kind of. Diplomacy is a funny area, and Caitlin can tell us a little bit more about this, but people can screw it up pretty easily. And so one of the threads through our discussion group has been, what is normal about this administration, what is different. Well, Caitlin is an authority on what is a normal diplomatic screw up. and what's not as normal. So Caitlin, here's a question that we had last week that I would kind of like to start with. Is it normal to lose track of your aircraft carrier group and not know whether they're headed toward the Korean Peninsula?
No, it's not normal at all.
Okay.
usually you know where they are. I think what struck me as really unusual about that, aside from the fact that there was a miscommunication about where the aircraft carrier actually was that it took so long to correct, right? Mm-hmm. Like there were people who knew that the aircraft carrier was headed in a different direction and that didn't get communicated immediately. Knowing what I know about how those things get communicated, were it me several years ago sitting in the seat I was sitting in at the NSC, we would have figured out how to fix that really quickly. And not just correct the record, but explain why that error came to be, and it seems it took the Trump administration a little bit more time to explain that than I would have expected.
Well, now, so it's not normal to lose track of your battleships, so to speak, but what is pretty normal is you, government making a mistake and the White House sort of, misspeaking and then having to clean it up, right?
Yeah.
What's distinct here seems to be like the time frame in which it took to correct the issue. Is that sort of what we're like we have a 1 week period of time where we think the Carl Vinson's heading toward Korea, and it added to this real, from a diplomatic standpoint, that seemed to do, it's the opposite of what the doctor says, do no harm, right? Like it seemed to exacerbate a tense situation.
Yeah, I think what was really unique about this was not just that the aircraft carrier was in a different position, but that it was part of, talking about where it was and where it was heading was part of a sort of a public diplomatic mm-hmm. push by the Trump administration to kind of pressure the North Koreans. And so the fact that they were talking about it and not getting it quite right, I think, had really high stakes.
Mm-hmm.
It's often the case that we will have to correct the record. It was 1,200 troops instead of 1,100 troops, or there are things that are wrong occasionally. But when they're that high level and that important as part of a diplomatic effort, that's the kind of stuff that you would expect to be very carefully mm-hmm. checked and coordinated. So that's what struck me as really interesting about this, and also the terminology of calling this an armada that has a particular implication.
Calls to mind my European history classes and the Spanish Armada,
Yeah.
So
which in all my time I don't remember ever talking about an armada. It's like I've been doing this for a while, and so there's a, when you start to find a new way to talk about things and a new way to put pressure on adversaries, I think there's a pressure testing here, and sometimes it's going to work out well, and sometimes you're going to find that approach doesn't work the way you think it does.
Interesting. So I want to take that back just a step because obviously there's a communications problem here. But one of the things that we've discussed is that over the first 100 days, these types of communications issues are exacerbated by the fact that we have a new administration doing new things for the first time. When you see something like that, do you have a little bit of sympathy because it's like a new comm shop and you're trying, people who have not seen the full scope of like the kind of communication level that's required over the to run the federal government, basically.
Yeah, I do. On the one hand, I have a lot of sympathy for the fact that people who, in many cases, came together to campaign now suddenly have a new task of governing that they, many of them, are not familiar with. The game changes. The scope of what you have to do changes. And so it's
the stakes are improbably a lot higher, right?
Yeah, and you may feel on a campaign that everybody's watching what you do really closely. When you are in government, they're watching even more closely, every little thing. And so there's a lot of pressure there that you have to kind of be prepared for. So in that way, you know, they have a steep learning curve. I get that. Every administration has that. I think where I have less sympathy is that in a way that we haven't seen in past administrations, this administration has chosen not to take advantage of the career expertise that exists mm-hmm. that could help guide them through this process and help minimize the mistakes. Mm-hmm. CJ knows this, but I was a career State Department person. I started in the Bush administration and then eventually went over to the Obama White House. And I went over to the White House at the very beginning of the Obama administration in 2009 because they looked around and realized that they needed people who knew how to do this work. And they reached out across the government, State Department, Defense Department, the intelligence agencies, and said, who are your best people at this task and this task and this task? We want them. And I was asked to go over, and the immediate assumption from the people on the Obama team was, you know what you're doing, we can, you know, unless you give us a reason not to trust you, we can trust you, are you ready to be a part of the team? Mm-hmm. And was sort of taken in from the very beginning. And it was a weird time because the White House processes are not set up. It takes us longer to figure out how to do things. That's normal.
Sometimes people literally don't know where the bathrooms are or how to work the light switches, right?
Yeah. Exactly. So that's normal, but I think the administration has really lost a lot in not taking advantage of those people who have been there and done it before. There's some of the recent articles that have been out about some of the people who are career folks who are being let go or moved mm-hmm. around. Reporters are calling them Obama holdovers. And in fact, a lot of these people took their jobs under the Clinton administration or the Bush administration. They're career folks who serve the office, who serve the Constitution, who are not there for a particular president. And I think that is where I sort of lose sympathy for some of these mistakes. Mistakes are inevitable, it's a steep learning curve, but there are ways to make it easier on yourself.
So talk about your experience in terms of previous administrations. During the first 100 days, they're getting their bearings, and the National Security Council in particular is nothing in the White House is completely non-political, but it's a hypothetically non-political body mm-hmm. that's judged more on its expertise.
Yeah.
Normally, the way White Houses operate here is to pull lots of staff from their field of sort of career experts mm-hmm. and build that staff until they can get a floor, and then maybe 6 months in, the NSC takes more of the shape of mm-hmm. The leader who is running it, right?
Yeah.
You're saying we don't see that as much with President Trump. We obviously the National Security Council has had a kind of a unusual degree of tumult, given that we had a National Security Advisor appointed and then resigned within a month, which is we'll mark that one down as not typical, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, they have had a lot of change. There have been, very quickly after he was appointed, the person who was running their Western Hemisphere affairs, kind of focusing on North America, was dismissed because of comments, reportedly because of comments he made at a think tank session that weren't in line with what, the administration wanted to be saying. The Deputy National Security Advisor, KT McFarland, there are stories out there that she's going to be moved to a new post fairly soon. So there is a lot of tumult there in the NSC, and you're absolutely right. The way that it normally, typically would work is something like 85-90% of the people at the National Security Council are career staff. They're there on detail. So they're kind of on loan from their department, usually for a year at a time. Some people extend mm-hmm. For a second year. I was there for 4 years. There are people who are there longer. But what the incoming administration does is appoint sort of the senior directors and the people mm-hmm. above that level, the sort of political appointees who are in charge of leading those offices. But they're largely staffed by career people. And what's happened this time is, in some cases, and I have a number of friends who are in this position, where they had a detail that was supposed to continue through this administration, and after seeing the changes that were in place during the transition, decided they didn't want to continue, so have gone back to their home departments. Mm-hmm. So you've got a little deficit in that sense, in the way that some of the people who should be there are no longer there. And the administration, I think, is a little bit slow to kind of pull in people from the bureaucracy that could be filling those gaps.
Now, we've focused a lot, both as a nation and in our discussion group, on sort of the White House. But one of the things that I wanted to talk to you about today is broader government, State Department, in terms of the first 100 days there. We've seen the behavior or the way the White House is run affecting our diplomatic corps.
Yeah.
And I know you still have lots of friends in the State Department. What would you say the mood is there? Are they nervous, cautious? What's the sense of how things have gone for them, 100 days into President Trump's tenure?
There's a lot of anxiety among the career folks at the State Department. I think they have a secretary who I think is beginning to assert himself, and people are starting to understand his leadership style, which is very useful. But at the same time, they're being faced with potential massive budget cuts from the White House in the proposed budget that really tells them that a lot of the work that they're doing doesn't need to be done.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of the jobs that should be having nominees named and going through confirmation, that's not happening. So there are leadership gaps there. People don't know where they're supposed to take guidance from. And you've probably seen this on any given day. There are slightly different messages coming out of the White House versus the Pentagon versus the State Department. So exactly what policy they're supposed to be implementing is also not clear to them. So I think there's a lot of uncertainty, a lot of anxiety about where key policies are headed, and when are they going to have leadership in their department? When mm-hmm. is the deputy secretary going to go through confirmation? When are the undersecretaries
right.
going to be named? When are the assistant secretaries going to be named?
Right. Well,
that's not clear.
I mean, a lot of people think about the State Department as the Secretary of State and then a bazillion career employees. But really, there are dozens of Senate confirmed positions that are
yeah.
career appointees that flip over. And essentially, it's Rex Tillerson and a lot of people who aren't necessarily familiar with Rex Tillerson at this point, right?
Right. He's not a known quantity.
He's also not
to
a
them.
Known quantity to them because he's coming from the private sector. So,
right. And he's not staffed himself with career people that they know either. So they're trying to get a read on his style and where his priorities are going to be and how to work with him.
Mm-hmm. Now, With that sort of preamble, I'm interested, what have you made of as a former diplomat, national security spokesman, what have you made of the first 100 days of President Trump from the sort of external global communications standpoint? What observations do you have?
I have a lot of observations, but given the time constraints we have here,
yeah.
I think what has struck me is how much action has been packed into this 100 days. And you and I were just mentioning this earlier. I think every administration has priorities they want to hit the ground running with, and they don't all work out.
Mm-hmm.
If you look back at President Obama's first 100 days on his first day in office, he made a promise that we were going to close Guantanamo, which still has not happened. Not for any lack of trying on the administration's
mm-hmm.
part, but so there are definitely sort of missteps and promises that don't come true that are made in the first 100 days, and there's a lot of action. But what struck me as really different this time is just while there are planned actions that are being taken to show that there's a lot of momentum, I think there are also a lot of kind of unplanned actions that are causing a lot of churn and that are causing a lot of news. In the international sphere that have to be cleared up.
So what's an example of something that you would consider? I think that all of us, journalists in particular, we spin our wheels thinking about what was is this an example of someone being crazy like a fox, or is this an example of someone being just crazy? And that
mm-hmm.
applies to President Trump, or any number of leaders I've covered, because you know, the desire of people like President Trump is to, and President Obama before him, is to make even mistakes look like they were pre-planned, mm-hmm. you know, diversions. What's an example of something that you view as like a, you know, what's an example of President Trump executing on a priority or like making a clear statement to the world and that you've noticed?
Well, I think the clearest statement he made was in reacting to chemical weapons in Syria, mm-hmm. And took firm action that I think a lot of people felt was necessary, and he stood behind it, and he articulated why he did it. I think the question a lot of us have is it part of a bigger plan? What's the bigger strategy? Mm-hmm. But I think he showed himself kind of, he had always said he would not hesitate to act when needed. He showed us that he would do that, and for a very good reason. I think there are a lot of people on both sides of the aisle who have applauded that action as something that needed to be done. But there are other things where kinks are really being worked out here that that perhaps could have been avoided. If you look at the way that the president has approached NATO, mm-hmm. I think some of the statements he's made have shown a fundamental misunderstanding of how right. NATO works as a collective body. And you saw Secretary...
Well, it was irrelevant. Now it's not.
And now it's not. Yeah. And what you saw, I think, this past week, I forget which interview it was in, the president said, you know, when I said that NATO was obsolete, I didn't really know enough about NATO, but now that I do, I don't think that anymore. These were knowable things, in my opinion. Mm-hmm. You saw Secretary Tillerson decline to go to the NATO summit or to the NATO ministerial because he needed to be with President Trump and his meeting with the Chinese leader. The signal that sent was chilling to a lot of our allies who were really surprised that the new Secretary of State would skip a NATO meeting. And so very quickly you saw the State Department right. rush to correct that. Say that he would in fact go at another date, and then within a day of that, putting out a statement saying that Trump was going to welcome the NATO Secretary General to Washington and that he himself was gonna go to the next NATO summit. So quickly corrected, but I think they sent a signal there that they didn't really intend to send. So on the one hand, on Syria, I think he's keeping promises he made and kind of sticking with a policy that, you know, he is being a bit consistent with, where on some other things, it's a little less consistent.
Now, some of that lack of consistency is about being new, right? Mm-hmm. Are there, when you see something like Secretary Tillerson sort of having, you know, kind of like a breach of diplomatic protocol with NATO, do you have some sympathy there because they're struggling to understand the nuances of their new job, or do you think that's down to like a lack of preparation or something?
I have less sympathy on this one. Mm-hmm. Having been through the transition from the Bush administration to the Obama administration, at that point my job was, I wasn't doing communications at that point, I was doing policy. I was doing South and Central Asia policy, so focusing mostly on Afghanistan and Pakistan. And one of my jobs was to write transition papers for the incoming administration to say, here are the things, mm-hmm. here are the most important issues for you to be focused on. Here are the recommendations for how we think you should approach them. Here are the complexities of these issues. And then usually the secretary would have meetings with us in person to kind of walk through some of this. And I think when it comes to NATO, it's been the cornerstone of, you know, European security. For me, that's a pretty...
Bigly.
It's a really yeah. big one. So the idea that they wouldn't have known the signal that would send, I think was a knowable thing, and okay. So I have less sympathy on that. I think there are some extremely complex issues out there where absolutely there are going to be missteps.
Have you seen something where the press has sort of hammered President Trump or Secretary Tillerson, and you're just like, you know, that could happen to anyone.
Yeah.
This is just is there an example that you can think of?
Well, I would say there have probably been a lot of misspeaks where someone has just mm-hmm. used the wrong word, and it's really clear it wasn't intentional. Mm-hmm. When President Trump said Iraq instead of Syria in an interview, that could happen to anyone, and in fact it does. Right. I think that the press by and large has done a very good job of holding to account where there are missteps and there are problems, but I also think that there's a very short fuse now, and
yeah.
very immediately when something seems like it might be a little bit off. We very quickly are tweeting about it and and proposing that this was a mistake based on a lack of knowledge, when the fact is it is a really high pressure job to have to constantly be talking in a way where everybody is looking at every word for hidden meaning. It's just not something anybody is used to. It's a thing you have to kind of grow into.
Right. And when we talk about sort of public diplomacy, the global stage, words really matter quite a bit, right?
Yeah.
Can you talk, like, in your experience, and I've done Caitlin a little bit of a disservice because I didn't get into her extensive background, but I'm hoping this question can kind of guide us through it. You worked a lot in, you know, like in Asia. Each country has its own pressure points and its own sort of like, you know, like things that you're supposed to say and things that you don't say. Can you talk a little bit about the, you know, that from a global affairs standpoint, like presidents and secretaries of state are held to a certain standard. You know, like what's been your experience in terms of, you know, how they have to manage their rhetoric or manage their, you know, like what they say?
Yeah, oh, it's incredibly important. And my, you know, sitting at the NSC, my job as the spokesperson was many things, but, you know, to take inquiries from the press about things the president would say. And if the president would use a country as an example in an offhand way, we would immediately get calls from all the media in that country saying, what did the president mean when he mentioned Cyprus? Well, he just meant that it was part of a list of countries that, you know, could apply to this issue. And for they're watched so closely that every word really does matter. And it's part of the reason we had such extensive processes to prepare the president by giving him memos that would talk about how we talk about an issue if needed. He sets the policy, so the way that the president talks about something drives the way that the rest of us will talk about it. We always consulted with the policy experts in that area on that issue to make sure that we were using the right vernacular, because some of the words that we use have been negotiated with our partners over many, many years and have meaning to them in ways that we don't necessarily see them. And so by changing the words, that can send signals to our allies. So it matters incredibly. And I think, you know, the way, one of the challenges that I think has been evident for the people in the administration now is to have a president who very much likes to work on Twitter, where everything must get compressed. The nuance that you would normally want to communicate in a full statement, it's just not possible there. And so the words are being changed and I think interpreted in different ways than perhaps the president intended them in every case.
So President Obama never bugged you guys to let him loose on Twitter a little bit more, or?
No. He tweeted. There were tweets that he drafted himself, but there were also tweets that we would recommend that the president send. But no, he didn't want to spend more of his time on Twitter. There's a lot of work to be done in the Oval Office, and I think he wanted to spend it in a different way.
Okay. What's an example of some, like, you talked about, like, you know, maybe, you know, we're all, like, I think that the average citizen doesn't realize that, you know, when they mention Cyprus, they might be, you know, irritating Cyprus or something. Is there an example of, like, in your time with President Obama, where he sort of, you know, for lack of a better word, sort of screwed up one of those types of situations where, you know, he said something that's sort of offhand? And the reason I ask this is that I want, you know, to understand what, like, whether it's like, you know, our presidents aren't perfect, right? Like, they're going to misspeak, they're going to say things that are sort of not right. But can you think of an example during your time when you kind of had to do a little bit of cleanup or?
Yeah. There were, and I'm struggling to remember a specific example, there were plenty of times where the president might get a fact slightly wrong, get a number wrong, misspeak a name, where we would absolutely have to talk to reporters and talk to stakeholders in the public and say, you know, what the president intended to say was this. What the president was, you know, what he was talking about was this. Put it in the right context, or actually just correct what he said. I think the there are sort of mistakes, and then there are times when the president breaks new policy ground where we have to quickly catch up and say, okay, is that what he meant to say? and if the answer is yes, great, then we're going to go out and explain it. And if it wasn't, then our job is to help kind of smooth that over, explain what he did mean to say.
So what's harder? If the president makes new policy and means to make new policy, and then you suddenly have to retrofit your communications to that, or if the president just flatly misstates U.S. policy or changes U.S. policy and then wants it walked back as a communicator? Or are they both kind of distinct?
They both
challenges?
Have their own challenges, yeah. Right? If you're hearing about new policy for the first time, that means, wow, there's a lot of work we all need to get doing to put that policy onto paper, make sure that everybody knows how we're going to talk about it, and then actually put in place the systems to implement that policy if we've got new policy. So that's the challenge of that is not a public-facing one. It's an mm-hmm. internal challenge. The challenge in having to correct something a president may say that's wrong is not as much work behind it. It's a little more embarrassing is not the right word, but you're a little more exposed
yep.
in the work that you have to do there because you're cleaning it up with the press, which is never fun, right?
Yeah. Now, Caitlin, you've traveled extensively as a diplomat. How closely do other nations follow our politics? I mean, and that's something like. Is the average citizen in one of the stands in Asia going to be plugged into, what President Trump's been doing over the last 100 days? Or
Yes. I even since leaving the government, I've been amazed at, and I'm sure we've all had these conversations with friends from other countries. My husband is a European diplomat, and in talking to his colleagues and talking to people that he talks to, they knew every twist and turn of what was going on in our primaries mm-hmm. and in our elections. It was all over their news. Talking to people from Australia and Finland and France, and they are following it really closely. And that's because people understand that what's happening here impacts our ability to lead the world, and,
right.
and in many cases impacts their countries, whether it's their security or the budgets, the development assistance we provide. And I found very much, I lived and served in Afghanistan for 18 months and found that there, among the kind of Afghan government and the Afghan elite, there was a lot more recognition of what was going on in our political system at home than I would have thought.
Mm-hmm.
They have their own political twists and turns to be paying attention to, but at the same time, they understand that our system is going to have an effect on them. And so, yeah, I'm always amazed at the press coverage. The very detailed press coverage in other countries of what is happening
here.
Do you
think that's more or less so under President Trump? Is that,
I'm not sure how to quantify it, but I think this has been an incredibly strange and eventful election in the U.S.
Yeah.
Because of the notoriety of the candidates that we had, both Secretary Clinton being so well known and President Trump being such a different kind of candidate, and the policies he's talked about being so very different from the Republicans who came before him, that I do think it probably got more attention and more focus than most. And again, some of that comes back to the president's talking about foreign policy in a way that has had less specifics attached to it,
right.
Leaving many countries to kind of keep tuning in to find out what does this mean.
Right. We'll get pretty soon get to some audience questions because I'm sure that they have a lot of questions about what we're seeing from kind of a global perspective. I'm wondering, as you look beyond sort of our 100-day window, to what challenges President Trump has set himself up for. What are you most what issues are you focused on given your experience? We have North Korea, we have Syria, we have whatever's going on with Russia, we have a seemingly new approach to China. What are the big issues that you're looking at kind of as we as we get out of 100 days and onto
yeah.
the course of President Trump's presidency?
I mean, it could be a laundry list. You laid out, I think, a lot of the kind of key priority areas, but one of the things that the administration laid out at the beginning they wanted to tackle was the Middle East peace process. And we saw a little bit of momentum on that earlier on, but I think that's something that they're going to have to figure out how they're going to deal with, particularly as the Israelis kind of push forward on settlements and change how they're talking about that. For me, the big issue really comes down to what happens with the budget for the State Department, the Defense Department, for USAID, because so much of that is going to drive what we're going to be able to do in support of other countries. And it's not just sort of development assistance, but security assistance. Are we going to be able to continue training, you know, local defense forces in countries where the United States doesn't want to have boots on the ground? We saw action in Yemen early in the administration. I think that's an area we need to continue to pay close attention to. All the things that were issues for the last administration, those, I don't think those have changed. There's still things that we need to focus on. But I do think kind of how we end up moving forward on diplomacy is the really big thing in my mind, is how actively are we going to be pursuing diplomacy. I think the other issue to pay attention to is where we end up on the Paris climate talks. There's sort of hard security issues that we have to focus on that are going to feel really urgent, but there are also a lot of sort of softer, sort of non-traditional national security issues that we have to pay attention to as well. For me, climate is a big one, because if we spend 4 or 8 years headed in a different direction, I think there's a lot to think about there.
Right. I mean, and the other thing that we've talked about, I think, is when nations see the U.S. veering one way and then veering the other on an issue, like it could be climate change or it could be any number of topics, it becomes, you know, more complex to manage relations to some degree, right?
Absolutely. If countries are not sure we're going to have a consistent path on something, it throws uncertainty into their own calculations about how they're going to move forward. Whether it's about how they're going to fund things, whether how they're going to staff things, where they're going to move their militaries, what military equipment they're going to decide to purchase or build, what kinds of alliances they're going to start to build for themselves with other countries, what capabilities they're going to pursue. Uncertainty, for when we project a sense of uncertainty, that causes other people to change the way they're thinking about us as a partner and what might happen. So I think it has been a particularly confusing period for our allies, who both are trying to understand the public comments that we're making and what that means about our policy, but also trying to find who are the right officials they can talk to that really represent what the policy is. Because I think, as we discussed earlier, not all the positions are filled. The people you would normally talk to may not be there. And the people who are acting, as we say, those are people who are filling those jobs right now, may or may not actually be a part of the policy processes that are being run at the White House. So they're giving allies our very best sense of what's going on, but they may not know where the policy is really going. So I think it's very concerning for a lot of our allies to have this kind of uncertainty.
Sure. And do you think that's, you know, like, obviously you have a new administration, you have a new party in this country, you're going to get a different approach to things. We've seen, you know, like certain policies in the international realm will just tend to flip from one party to the other. Mm-hmm. Like, do you think that's more exacerbated under President Trump? Because, you know, we as a nation seem to have a hard time getting a read on him sometimes. I can only imagine what, you know, a bureaucrat in China or someone else in government is trying to do when they're trying to interpret things.
Yeah, I hate continuing to give the answer that yes, I think this is different for everything, but I do feel like this is somewhat different. And I think, you know, part of our not being able to understand where things are headed is, as the president has told us, by his own design, right? That he doesn't want to telegraph.
Right, lack of predictability is a part of his foreign policy.
Yeah,
right?
which is a change, right?
Yeah.
The Obama administration came in very much with the express purpose of wanting to kind of rebuild relationships with our partners around the world, you know, kind of reassure partners of the U.S. leadership in the world. And this administration has decided to take a different path. And you and I talked about this a little bit earlier, rather than kind of go out and sort of do foreign trips to capitals to show people the kind of engagement that we want, he has welcomed people to the U.S. and said, kind of, come here.
Come to America
first. Let us host you. And I think that sent a different signal. So I do feel like this is just a different way of engaging, and it is harder for people to know where we're going. I think what's really difficult for us to judge from the outside is how much of this is calculated policy, and how much of it is just the fact that policy hasn't been worked out yet. Mm-hmm. We just don't know, and because I think a lot of this is not being explained publicly.
I have just a couple more questions before I turn it over to our audience. One, I'm interested what the most fun you had while working at the White House was, and two, what the most challenging day you can remember at the White House was.
Yeah.
And if they're the same day, then I want to question
them. They are not the same day. Okay. So there are certainly a lot of fun days at the White House, if you can imagine that. And most of them were not because of what was happening so much in the world, because usually you know, the good stuff doesn't always come to the White House. The good stuff can be worked out by the agencies. The things that are really complicated and hard and problematic end up coming to the White House. But the thing I would tell you about the working there is, I had the best colleagues in the whole world. The most supportive, most wonderful, hardest working, dedicated colleagues who wanted all of us to succeed. And so the amount of times that we bucked each other up that turned into sort of 8 or 9 p.m., you know, let's turn on some music and like dance it out for a couple minutes in the middle of the Eisenhower Executive Office building.
That doesn't happen in the sit room, does it?
No. Okay. You can't take anything electronic in the sit room. It's depressing in that way.
My son was a month old and he was in the sit room, youngest baby ever with security clearance.
There you go.
Anyway.
And I have to tell you, if you are a national security person who watches any of the shows on TV, like Homeland, nothing irks you more than people like going into the fake sit rooms with their phones and making calls. Like, you can't do that. You're just cut off altogether sitting in that room for hours.
That room is much smaller than it ever looks on
TV,
right?
At the White House is smaller than you think it is. But yes, those rooms are smaller. They're kept at an incredibly cold temperature, so you're cold and you can't go anywhere and you can't look at anything. But it forces you to actually focus on the discussion, which is really important. So I had so many fun memories just with my colleagues of trying to, like, in the middle of incredibly crazy moments, trying to find some levity and trying to kind of keep ourselves going. Mm-hmm. There was a really fun moment, not this past World Cup, but the World Cup before that, where the U.S. was doing really well, and like everybody in the U.S. was crazy about it, and that spread to the White House as well. So
this is the 2010 World Cup.
Yes.
Where, if I may be a sports fan.
Yes,
here,
please.
Had a very dramatic.
With that Tim Howard game. Yeah.
Game-winning goal that sent them to the next round in the 93rd minute or something. Yeah.
But everybody at the White House, and those games were sort of on in the middle of the day, so we would all take our Blackberries and go find a TV, and there would be snacks, and we would take a break for 30 minutes or an hour or whatever to kind of sit and watch these together. Mm. So last week's guest, Terry Suplat, who's one of my favorite people in the world, Terry's office was next to mine in the West Wing. Terry shared an office with Cody Keenan, the president's chief speechwriter. I shared an office with Ben Rhodes, who's the deputy national security advisor for strategic communications. So our two offices got together in Cody's office and sat on Cody's couch and had snacks from the mess and just let ourselves watch the game and cheer and have a great time. And there was actually a point in that World Cup series where they opened up the South Court Auditorium, mm-hmm. Which is the biggest space we've got in the Eisenhower Executive Office building, and put on the game so that everybody could watch it. The president actually showed up, took a seat, watched the game with people for a while. So there were really fun moments like that. But most of them were about people. I think for me, I was there for a lot of different crises. Frankly, so were my predecessors and my successors. I think the most trying times for me were, I think there were really three that stick out. One, I led the communications on all the Edward Snowden issues. Mm. I was the first person to get the call from The Guardian that they had this document that none of us really knew what it was. But there were a lot of rough days with that, and it just felt like it was never going to end. The other was kind of running point on all the Bo Bergdahl communication issues, mm-hmm. And the sort of the high and low of that
sure.
process of the complete stress of knowing that there were people at that very moment on their way to go get him, and the stress of that, and the nervousness that you've got people in harm's way, and then the sort of relief that he's back, and then all the fallout from that, and really sort of struggling to understand all the emotions that were flying around. And then the last for me was I also was leading the communications for the interagency around the hostages in Syria, Jim Foley and his compatriots. So the being involved in the lead up to all the planning for the operations to try and rescue them, and then when they were murdered, kind of figuring out how to respond to that, because we're all very emotional as well, and trying to make sure that we respond in a way that is appropriate and sensitive to his family,
right.
but that also sends the right message on behalf of the United States about what this means for our policy and our resolve. So those are really hard moments to work in when you lose an American citizen or there's a tragedy of trying to do your job while you're also trying to remember the people that you're affecting by the words that you use.
So I think I realized that I asked that question in the wrong order, because we're going to
happy moment.
Yeah, we're going to kick it over to the audience.
Now that I've thoroughly depressed you, does anyone?
No, I think one thing I would say is what I hear from you is that these types of challenges are innate to working at the White House. That
yeah.
every administration is going to face those challenges. I find that to be kind of a really interesting element as we look out across President Trump's first 100 days. With that, Caitlin has like a wealth of experience in foreign policy, diplomacy. I'm sure our audience has some excellent questions for you, and they usually ask better questions than me, so let's have at it.
Okay.
Could you speak a little bit about the role of Ambassador Nikki Haley within the administration and like the UN Security Council in relationship to the National Security Council? As a nominee, she was one of the least contentious within the Trump administration. So do you think she's kind of carried the sentiment of the country like in the actions in Syria, and where do you see her moving forward?
Yeah, so Ambassador Haley is part of the president's cabinet. The position she's filling in different administrations has been elevated to the cabinet, and at other times has not been a part of the cabinet. Under the Obama administration, it was. So she's playing a key foreign policy advisory role here. And I think just the other day, President Trump met with Ambassador Haley and all the ambassadors from the Security Council. Security Council is an incredibly important body, and her interaction with those colleagues is going to be really important to the Trump administration's ability to kind of carry things out multilaterally on an international stage. And she has, I think, stood out for being very blunt and being very tough on Russia. And that's something that at times has struck people as dissonant with what they heard coming out of the White House or the State Department. So I say this not knowing her and not knowing what's going on behind the scenes, but seems very much a strong player who is going to assert herself publicly on what she thinks is the right place for the United States to be on the world stage. As she kind of continues in this job, you can only assume she will, continue to grow in her mastery of how the UN works. What are the things that they can bring to the table? I think what's going to be a huge challenge for her that that the ambassadors in the Obama administration didn't quite face is the budget cuts that the Trump administration has telegraphed they want to make in terms of funding for the UN. So she's going to be, I think, in a tough spot to, on the one hand, say that the United States is going to continue to play a leading role, but on the other hand, say we're going to pull back our support and not pay for some of the crucial things that the UN thinks that it needs. In terms of the way the coordination happens, she sits on the National Security Council. Her staff will, I don't know how the Trump administration is organizing things, but the way it worked for us under the Obama administration is that the spokesperson at the U.S. mission to the United Nations was a part of our morning phone calls. We would have a phone call every single morning at 9 a.m. with all the national security agencies to talk about what were the most important issues we need to focus on that day, decide who was going to take the lead on speaking about various issues, her staff would have been a part of those calls under our team. So I hope that they are very much linked in and looped in on the policy side and the communication side the way that they were before. But I think she is just her influence is going to continue to grow the longer she kind of is there, and I think provides a really valuable sense for the administration of what other countries are thinking, because she's there with them every single day, working with them and in these meetings.
Right. I mean, the job of the UN ambassador is normally to, in part, distill sort of international public opinion, like what the other diplomats are talking about on the streets, so to speak. The other thing that I would say to this, that it's been reported, and I found this just sort of personally interesting about her, before she became UN ambassador, it's been reported that President Trump offered her Secretary of State and that she declined it because she wanted to build her base of knowledge. And, you know, that may be hagiographic spinning from people who want to, like, help her build her public image. But that idea that we take a job that is, like, less than the best one we're offered because we want to, like, kind of learn more and do it right when we get there is kind of an interesting concept. More questions?
I've been unimpressed by, I guess, Trump's diplomacy, and I guess in a lot of respects, it appears to me that he, when he meets with a group, he'll say what they want to hear, such as with China. And also, what do you think about diplomacy by Jared? I mean, do you think that's an effective
way to... Diplomacy by?
Jared Kushner.
Ah.
Someone inexperienced in foreign policy.
As opposed to the jeweler, Jared, right?
Yeah.
Like, yeah.
Yeah.
So I'm just curious if you think that's effective.
Yeah, so I honestly don't know that I can answer your second question, only in the sense that I don't know that I know with any authority what diplomacy he's carrying out.
Mm-hmm.
What I have seen is him, through the press, trying to meet with people that work on these areas, that are experts on these areas, to understand what the challenges are. I'm not sure what diplomacy he's carried out yet, so I will reserve judgment on that question. I'm happy to answer it at some other time. On the way President Trump conducts diplomacy, you know, I hesitate to try to analyze whether it is a case of he says what he wants people to hear, or whether he is responding to learning from mm-hmm. these discussions. If you look at the interview he did with the Wall Street Journal, where he kind of laid out some of the discussions that were happening at Mar-a-Lago with the Chinese premier on North Korea, when he said, you know, I thought that the Chinese could exert much more influence on North Korea than they were, but once I listened to the Chinese premier for 10 minutes, I understood it was much more complicated.
Hmm.
And then came out of that with a different view. So I don't know which of the two, or if it's a mix of those. But we have seen him change his views after he has dug into a subject more. And I don't know, I was reading just yesterday, I want to say, that Prime Minister Trudeau gave an interview where he was asked about, of Canada, was asked about President Trump. And he was asked sort of, what have you learned about him? And one of the things that the Prime Minister said was that he listens. He listens and he learns.
Mm-hmm.
I've seen him take in more information and start to change the way that he thinks because he's listening. He's listening to learn more.
Right. And that's sometimes been ascribed as a negative trait, right? That he's someone who, if you're the last person in the room, you're going to have the most influence over him.
Mm-hmm.
But it's interesting to hear a foreign leader sort of describe that as a positive trait,
mm-hmm.
in that they. You know, we tend to think listening in general is a good thing, right? My wife tells me it is.
Yes. He, of course, said that before yesterday's call, where they apparently went at it about soft lumber.
You would not know that from the White House's readout.
No, it was very
two sentences,
slim.
But the Canadian version was as expansive as Alberta. So,
indeed.
More questions, guys.
Yes, one, thank you for your service, by the way.
Sure.
Appreciate what you've done. Just in terms of the deputy positions, those that require, and others that require Senate approval, when we should we start to worry when 20% of them are filled?
Yeah.
Is it now?
I'm already worried. Just because we that process takes time. And so the fact that in some of these have in the last few weeks started to be named, which is good progress, but not in all cases. So I think we need to see these names being put forward as soon as possible so that Congress can start that process. I mean,
Senate confirmations tend to drag. Having covered a few, they tend to drag out.
They do, and I think we didn't talk about this, but one of the other things that I think was highly unusual about this transition and this 100 days was vetting. Mm-hmm. There are lots of reasons this could be, and one of the speculations is, of course, because the Trump team may not have expected to be in this position, but not having a stable of kind of vetted people mm-hmm. that are ready to go, they're having to do that catch-up work now. I'm concerned. I think we need to see these names as soon as we can. What I would assure you of, that gives me great comfort, is that there are thousands and thousands of career people manning these departments. They may not be named as the deputies. Mm-hmm. They may not necessarily be empowered on all issues, but there are really smart, dedicated people minding the store and helping make sure that things are happening and things are working. Mm-hmm. And I think you are already seeing by some of the position changes that are coming out from the administration that these bureaucracies are able to have some impact on where policies are headed just by educating and being involved and showing where some of the pitfalls are here. I've had conversations with some colleagues who are still at the State Department who actually feel like because there are no because the senior leaders are not there, that there's actually some space to run and continue to make policy on issues that are out of the spotlight because they're not being paid attention to from the White House and the NSC. Africa, for example, we haven't seen a lot out of the administration on how they would approach Africa. So the State Department's got to continue doing their work there. Mm-hmm. That means they can sort of drive some things forward, hopefully. So. There are some pitfalls to this, but I think there are, again, incredibly talented people minding the store, making things happen where they can on a daily basis.
See, there, Caitlin, we can end questions on uplifting notes if we try hard enough.
No. I'm sorry I've been so depressing.
It's
but
okay.
That's the life in national security.
Yeah. Hi, thank you both for being here. I wish more people were here to hear what you had to say. Russia hasn't been mentioned, but that's not my question. My understanding is that the reason that Syria was bombed was because Ivanka was upset with the pictures that she saw, but that seemed to be perfectly normal, and that before Syria was bombed, Putin had been notified and was able to get certain things out of the way, and that the airfield really was not destroyed. So is there any truth to that?
Caitlin, I know some of this from my reporting,
yeah,
so
go for
I'll...
And I'll pile on.
Yeah. I think there's the way it's come out. There's a thing called a deconflication line, which is a very fancy way of saying if we know we're going to bomb a facility, and we know that another country, it's a pretty standard military practice. And Caitlin, correct?
There's a hotline between militaries. We have it with Russia. We have it with other. We have it with China. We have it with other countries. Where if there's an action that we are about to take that could be seen as provocative or that could cause harm, where we give a heads up in that channel, a military-to-military
right.
channel, of basic information, so that something is not misinterpreted.
Right. So in President Trump's case, I believe that the deconflication line was used in order to avoid Russia believing that we were trying to kill Russian troops who were stationed at or near this Syrian facility, which would be, I think, pretty close to standard operating procedure. If President Obama took a similar action, I think that he probably would have taken a similar step. Where that gets a little bit interesting is, like when you follow the chain of common sense there, which is if DOD calls Russia on the decomplication line, will the Russians tell their people, their friends in the Syrian army that rockets are incoming or not? Well, like common sense to me as a skeptical reporter would be probably, but that's not technically what they're trying to do there, right?
No, that's certainly not the intent, and I think the military planners, whether they decide to hit runways or other structures, I couldn't really speak to, but I think they very clearly, sent a message here. 59 missiles is a lot of missiles, and so I think if they were really
but
trying,
not quite 60, I don't
know. Not quite 60, yeah. that if they were really trying to let somebody get out of this and just do something superficial, I think it would have looked slightly different. I have seen the reporting, and that, and I think, frankly, it came from Eric Trump as the source of some of this, saying that, Ivanka had this effect on the president and his decision making. I tend to hope and to expect that the president is going to be making decisions based on something more substantial than that. And in fact, I think Ivanka gave an interview just in the last day or so where she said that's not how she would have put it. So I don't know the real answer, but I tend to believe that this was far more about the use of chemical weapons and the impact that it had on the president himself than the opinions of the folks in his family, even though he, places very high value on those.
I mean, having said that, there's a there's a tradition, certainly, of, presidents being influenced by their family members.
Sure.
Ronald Reagan, President Obama, these are all leaders with spouses who have opinions, and they have pushed their own...
And I would expect, presidents to talk
Ivanka's
with their...
his daughter, not a spouse.
Right. But she has played a very close counselor role. Look, I would expect every president to talk about the hardest things that they have to deal with their spouse, to say, am I doing something that's true to myself? Is this the kind of decision I want to make? Is this the kind of person I want to be? Is this the kind of president I want to be? Just like any of us talk to our closest friends or our spouses about big decisions in our lives. So if he did that, I would expect that. And frankly, I think it's... an asset to have people that know you well who are able to kind of reflect with you on those things. But I think his job is to decide what's in the United States' best interest. And I think if you look at the reaction to this, there were people from the Obama administration and people from both sides of the aisle who thought this was the right thing to do. So how he came to that, I don't know, but I think there are a lot of people who think this was in our best interest.
More questions.
The investigation by the House and the Senate into the Russian influence on the election, or the Russian influence in the White House, do you feel that, or maybe it's not in your, that these people are dragging this out without kicking anything back? And also, you mentioned your husband is a diplomat in Europe, and it was pretty obvious that the Russians cooked the books on the election or influenced it. And so what's their take on it? Plus, is it in their mind that Trump is sort of like the Siberian candidate that is there because you have all these swing states that were won by very little? So it's pretty obvious that so anything happens is going to influence. Plus the FBI Secretary Comey dropping a thing at the end.
Yeah, I'm going to put on my old NSC hat where I say I'd like to sort of wait to see the results of the investigation into this before making a comment. Look, I think if you look at the way the Benghazi investigation was handled, there were certainly a lot of staff on that project. There are far fewer on this Russia probe. And members of Congress have been calling
out. No career prosecutors or, in some instances, no dedicated staff, I believe,
right.
yet in the House investigation. Right?
Yeah. So I think it's fair to say that this isn't being shown that level of urgency. I think there are a lot of us who think that it should be. These, regardless of party, this is a huge question of our national security about whether the Russians, whether and how they impacted not just our election, but their ties to the current administration. And that's something I would care about no matter who the president was. Mm-hmm. I mean, my husband is from Iceland, which is a NATO ally, a country with no military. They're the friendliest country you could be at, you could be from. And it still took many, 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 many months of security clearances for us to get married, right? Because we want to be really clear that the people in our government don't have any ties that could affect their ability to do their job and their ability to kind of keep our best interests at heart. So I think those are really important questions. Whether there's anything there or not, I don't know. But there's certainly enough there that this investigation is needed, and I think we need to see it through. And I'm personally concerned about it. I think we all need to be concerned about it. We're seeing it in France. We're seeing it elsewhere. It's certainly not unbelievable that the Russians would make such attempts. But I think, you know, I have to be really honest that as much as I would as a Democrat, as a someone who voted for Hillary Clinton, as much as I would like to blame, you know, some outside influence, the fact is President Trump resonates with a large number of people in the country who have really legitimate mm-hmm. grievances and needs that were not being met. And, you know, he was elected by a lot of people who really wanted something different from their government. So I think there were a lot of things going on here. And that's one we need to look into very seriously. I hope it moves forward in a way that's very serious.
Can I ask a follow-up to that? Caitlin, you worked a lot in, you know, former Soviet satellites and, mm-hmm. you know, areas where Russian influence is very high. One, like, you know, do you see sort of, so you've probably seen Russian influence campaigns. You've probably met some Russian spies.
Probably, yeah.
Can you talk a little bit about your...
Some of them are probably in my email right now.
Right.
Yep.
You know, my wife, Caitlin's former colleague, Johanna, got her iPhone stolen when she was in Moscow, which is why we probably still get some weird emails to this day. Or St. Petersburg, excuse me.
Yeah, I was there on that trip. They gave us a gift bag with a lot of stuff in it, including these phone chargers, as if, like, I'm going to plug my device into the charger you gave me.
So actually, this is the G20 in St. Petersburg.
St. Petersburg, yeah.
So it got this, like, you know, these guys, when they travel abroad, will sometimes get pretty decent swag bags, you know. Mm-hmm. This one had a really nice...
If you're really into mugs that it say, like, you know, mm-hmm. whatever summit at whatever place, then this is a job you want, because there's a lot of that.
It's always just kind of hilarious, because... the Chinese and the Russians always give you some form of, like, electronic uh-huh. tool when you're there, and it's like,
here's a new jump drive.
Yeah, hey, how about this cell phone charger that just looks
where
totally,
the light is on all the time, even when
totally
it's not
normal.
Plugged in.
Yeah. But the best part about that trip is Johanna got this sweatshirt. Like, really nice Russian-made fleece sweatshirt that says G20 St. Petersburg.
I didn't get one of those, and at the time I was really bummed.
Well, let me tell you, it had a recording device in it.
Yeah.
And it's a good thing she gave it to me, and all the, you know, FSB got was, like, me hoofing as I go jogging in D.C. But anyway, so more questions from the audience. I'm sorry, that was just sort of
a fun aside.
Yeah, a fun aside.
Back to vetting and the National Security Council, how did Michael Flynn happen? How did he...
I don't think the Trump administration quite knows.
How did he get through?
You guys are asking me a lot of questions I don't know the answers to, and I can speculate, but... I worked with General Flynn when in Afghanistan. So he, you know, he's.
So what's he like? Let's pick apart. Let's demystify him a little bit. He, you know, we've heard that he's a hard driver. I've actually heard he has a pretty, at least people that worked with him during his time in government, that he had a distinct sense of humor and a distinct kind of like point of view as these things go. But tell us about your experience working with, like, what's he like?
Well, I didn't work that closely with him. Those are my impressions of him that I think others are reflecting that are right. I mean, he's very smart, strong-willed. He obviously was doing a really tough job in Afghanistan, kind of leading our intelligence efforts there in a conflict zone. I think he's emblematic of the way that the president has staffed himself, right? His particular path, we know the president likes generals. We know he likes the military. He respects them. Mm-hmm. And we know he likes people who are loyal. And General Flynn was both of those things for him. And I think was around at a moment when the rest of the national security establishment on the Republican side was signing Never Trump letters and was saying, this is not right. So I think that's how he ended up where he was. There's no question he was an extremely experienced, national security official. I mean, he was. There's no question about how he got into that orbit. He's done tough assignments. He's taken on hard jobs. How successfully he did those jobs, I think, is the question. But he wasn't unqualified to be in that role. But I think the reasons he was in that role were the ones I just laid out.
You know, and in covering politicians, I would say you don't necessarily find like a carbon copy of General Flynn, but people who are around when a politician is at like their nadir or their low point, and for President Trump, that was, April, May 2016, when the Republican establishment is revolting against him and trying to stop him from becoming the nominee. People who are with you when you're down tend to be people that politicians will value because they want people who will go to the mattresses with them because they know that what's ahead of them are more challenges and more loyal, like sort of. And sometimes that can be a very good thing, or end up being a very positive relationship. I mean, President Obama had a number of aides that worked with him from almost the beginning of his Senate campaign, and even before that, to the end of his administration. That he was around was not necessarily surprising. I think that Caitlin's point, the lack of vetting there, knowing General Flynn's financial ties to certain countries or what he was doing in terms of like his private sector income, that reflects kind of a less intense approach to vetting than previous administrations in terms of the ones I've covered.
Yeah.
More questions. I think we have time for a few more.
Follow-up?
Yeah,
sure.
We allow follow-ups, yeah. I'm a reporter.
Less intense vetting, I mean, do you get to choose how you vet?
Sure.
I mean, how did he slip through? Is this on Mike Pence because he was in charge of the transition?
I don't know that I would ascribe, I don't know enough about the situation to ascribe blame to someone, but I would say, just in my experience covering administrations, when President Obama was elected in 2008, and Caitlin can talk more about this because she's actually been a government official. I just talked to them.
and we're married to one.
Yeah, and I'm married to one. But Johanna, for example, had to fill out an FBI background check. That's standard to work at the White House. But some of these appointments, and General Flynn had national security clearance and credentials based on his previous experience in government. So sometimes you tend to think, well, we can speed this along because we know what we're dealing with here. So that could be one example of how it happens. Also, there's FBI vetting, and then there's like what I would call political vetting, meaning like a researcher is looking at what General Flynn has done from the time he left government, which I think was like 2000. I'm not actually sure what year he left the government, but like what he's been doing between then and now, looking for like perceived, you know, sort of like
things. Has he made problematic statements?
Has he made problematic statements? Where has he traveled? You know, like what causes does he work for? In 2008, I remember, you know, Senator Tom Daschle was vetted really thoroughly by the Obama administration, and they found out that he had taken, you know, essentially had a car service in his job at a law firm that he hadn't paid taxes on, which is not necessarily something that would have come up in an FBI background check, but when it was unearthed by, you know, people examining him, he decided to withdraw himself from the process. As a counterexample to that, in 2016, when Treasury Secretary Mnuchin was, you know, kind of going through the confirmation process, it was revealed only when sort of like the Senate started asking him for financial documents that he actually had like a significantly larger income than he, like the public was sort of made aware of, and it was pretty apparent that no one had like at like Trump Tower had asked him for that information because everyone sort of reacted with a bit of surprise to it. And it wasn't necessarily like a disqualifying thing, you know, like to have more money than we thought you had is not, you know, the end of the world.
I think there's also just a process issue here in terms of sequence, right? Like some of these people are being properly vetted, but they're being announced before they've gone through the vetting.
Right.
Was it Deputy at Commerce or someone who just withdrew their name because they realized they had too many financial entanglements to...
Yeah, the guy, one of the owners of the Chicago Cubs.
Yeah. So, you know, the vetting is being done. It's just a little out of sequence. I think earlier in the administration, the vetting was not being done.
Right.
To get a security clearance, that's not a... The way that gets done is not something the administration can change or do differently. Those are sort of standard processes run by the security agencies. But the political vetting is very much up to each administration. What are the questions they want to ask? What are the things they care about? What are they looking for?
Right, and it becomes a question of optics versus like legalities, I guess, in some sense.
This was very serious in the Obama administration, even for people who were not cabinet level. There were times where people from the presidential personnel office would come to me and say, as the national security spokesperson, and say, we're thinking of this person who would have some national security in their job, and here's the report that we've pulled, here are some of the statements they've made. We think that they're not prohibitive, we think that they're fine, but we want your input on whether this is problematic from a national security standpoint.
And when Caitlin puts her foot down about soft lumber in Canada and says, nope, can't have this person here.
But we took it really, really seriously.
Yeah.
All the way from the top. Top on down.
Awesome. More questions?
Mine is a more general question than specifically about this. We hear statements like the White House is pushing back. The White House says spoke and so on. Who is that? Because there's not someone named White House there.
Yeah.
So how is that done? It's sort of the nuts and bolts of those sort of statements, pushback, et cetera.
Yeah.
Peel it back, Caitlin. Tell us how it's done.
Yeah. Well, the answer is not so straightforward. It could be many different ways. I assume you're asking about sort of unnamed White House officials, things like that.
They are often people just like Caitlin.
They're often people just like I was. Sometimes they are. This is not an organized thing. Like some official somewhere decides that either to show themselves. To be well plugged in to reporters and kind of build their own credentials, or sometimes it's because they disagree with a policy and want it out there that the White House is pushing on something. Sometimes they're just chatty.
Sometimes a concerted strategy, right?
Like, right. So, sorry, I was going too slowly on that, but sometimes it's not planned. Sometimes it's just somebody's talking. Sometimes it is a very concerted strategy to get it out there but without being formal, whether it's to sort of test the waters or because it's something that you shouldn't be talking about. Mm-hmm. There are often things that the White House shouldn't formally be talking about, but you want to help people understand. So you talk about it as an anonymous official. I would do that all the time, particularly on national security issues where you don't really want to be discussing the details of our diplomatic discussions, but a reporter's come to you with something that's wrong and you need to fix it, right? Mm-hmm. You want to tell them the correct version of the story, but without the other country being able to say, this official broke our diplomatic trust, right? So there are sometimes reasons where you would want to educate and you'd want to correct the record without formally discussing something in public because it breaks diplomatic norms or because maybe it's not really something you're ready to make a formal pronouncement on. But that could be someone at my level, it could be anyone really.
And when we anonymize, it also tends to help people at least temporarily avoid blame if a trial balloon or something. Like, I'll give you an example. Like, we had a story at Politico last week where White House officials wanted Congress to vote this week on a new healthcare repeal bill. Our reporting was solid on it. Our reporters had talked to a bunch of different people at the White House. Sometimes when you say the White House is pushing something, it's because you've talked to, an array of people, and you've drawn a consensus on what the White House staff would like to see done with a particular issue. But it also has this way of if Caitlin and Ben Rhodes and Susan Rice have all talked to the same reporter and none of them have agreed to attach their name to it, but they all say, President Obama really needs to visit Cyprus, and we say the White House is pushing a presidential visit to Cyprus.
Yeah.
It has a way of avoiding blame for those individuals also if the president's like, I do not like Cyprus. I would rather go to Moldova, right?
Yeah.
Like,
yeah, that's not a conversation I think ever happened, but yeah, it's a good example of what could happen. No, CJ's right. Sometimes it's so many people who have interacted with the White House who are sort of speaking on their behalf, but they're not supposed to be speaking on their behalf, mm-hmm. to represent what the White House is thinking. So if you brief members of Congress and then members of Congress go and say the White House wants this, that could be the source, but
right.
It could also be people sitting in the White House who are not supposed to be or not ready to be talking about something with their name attached to it on the record who are trying to get the right thing out there.
Awesome. I think we have time for like one or two more questions. Yeah.
Do you know KT McFarland? Did you ever work with her? She came in just with the Trump administration. And was she being reassigned so it's not as easy for her to testify?
Ah.
Oh.
I did not see that one coming. So I do not know her. She, I think from her bio, served at the White House, when I was in grade school. So I didn't work with her. She showed up, again, as part of the transition. To be clear, I left. I left government beginning of 2015, so I didn't interact with her at all. I don't know why she's being reassigned. I mean, the press would indicate that they found a role that's a better fit for her. The role
Ambassador of Singapore is good work if you can get it. It's not
absolutely.
A bad gig. It's a really nice
I have to tell you, the being the Deputy National Security Advisor is one of the hardest jobs in government. Coordinating the interagency across every important issue we have, it is endless meetings, it is constant arbitration between equities and agencies.
Who
it is the person who makes that place run.
Would that have been Ben Rhodes in the Obama administration, or?
There are a number of deputies. Okay. The role she was filling was the role that was most recently filled by Avril Haines, and
mm-hmm.
then Tony Blinken before that, mm-hmm. Dennis McDonough before that.
Dennis McDonough graduating to Chief of Staff of the White House. So it shows you the kind of competency level that job requires, I think.
Yeah, it's
not
intense,
that Avril
intensely
and,
grueling,
but, yeah.
and you have to. You have to really manage a lot of equities all at once in a way that people view as fair and equitable.
Mm-hmm.
What agencies hate is when the White House puts their thumb on the scale in a particular direction during a policy discussion. They really want it to be kind of an equitable discussion, and I think there's so many. That's the role that she was being asked to fill, and the reporting would indicate that. That there's a role where she could potentially be more useful.
Well, and I think with a new national security advisor, General McMaster, General H.R. McMaster, you always want in jobs like that, which are high stakes, very complicated, you want someone that you know that you can work closely with, that is kind of your person as your deputy. And so it's not really surprising to me that if K.T. McFarland was General Flynn's type of person for that type of role, that General McMaster, who's taken a different, you know, approach to the NSC, wants a different person in that job because it's a person.
And that's how
Caitlin
said,
you want someone who will, you know, I don't know that this happens with national security advisors, but like you need the kind of colleague who you're going to have a dance party with when things get a little bit too tense at the White House. You know,
you need your own people. You should be able to have your own people, assuming they're qualified and they pass all the requirements. You should get to have your team that you trust to implement that policy. So if that's the way the decision was made, I think that's fair.
Maybe one more question, and then I think we have to wrap up.
Thank you for being here.
Sure.
Wanted to ask you, what now do you do, and what do career diplomats do when they're no longer
career diplomats? So people make all kinds of different decisions.
They speak very carefully wherever they go.
They try to speak very carefully wherever they go. I currently work at a public relations firm in Washington called Edelman. It's the world's biggest public relations firm. We've got offices in
Your host could have done a better job of telling you that.
We just wanted to get right into the talking. But I think we've got offices in something like 68 countries. And I oversee our media team in Washington. So my job is to help our clients, who range from kind of small NGOs and startups to, you know, massive brands. Help them develop the right media strategy to kind of interact with media in a way that is going to help them tell their story in the way that they want. For me, I really struggled with what to do after government. I had invested almost 15 years in it and loved every single moment of it. You feel very mission-driven. You're part of something that I hope was doing a lot of good things in the world. And I was telling CJ this, I felt a little lost in terms of my identity of like, what if I'm not going to be in government, what am I? Like, who am I? What am I going to do?
Well, you're Caitlin.
I'm still me, but, what, you know, and when you do those jobs, particularly the job I had doing press for national security, it was 24/7. I mean, there's not much sleeping. You're responding to people all day. You're not present in your own life. You're just so focused on that job. And so I didn't really know what I wanted to do, but as I thought about it, I realized that there were a lot of communication skills that I needed to learn if I was going to kind of catch up with my peers in the private sector. When you are in government, there are certain tools that you use, and you use them really well, and use them at a really high level.
And some of them are very applicable to the outside world, and some of them are wildly idiosyncratic and do not belong anywhere outside of where they're, you know.
Yeah, that's true. But I realized there were a lot of things I wanted to learn, and as I started to talk to people about what made sense for me, I came around to the idea that working at an agency who had a lot of different capabilities and a lot of people that I could learn from was the right thing. And so I've had a blast over the past year and a half just learning. I had no private sector experience before, so how do companies work? Like, how do they actually do this business of communicating? Like, and how should we think about the business of doing, you know, what we do at agencies? So I'm learning things about how to use research that I had never used before. If you think about my old jobs, I didn't have research at my disposal of how
analytics
and stuff like that. We had no budget for that. We were going from crisis to crisis, issue to issue, and doing our very best to kind of use our experience and our instincts to make the right decisions. But now there are things I can know. I have time between issues to understand how people feel about a brand or an issue or a policy. Mm-hmm. So you're getting to learn how to use research and analytics. I'm really enjoying it. So for me, that was a place to go where I could learn things that I hadn't been exposed to. Also, I won't keep talking about him. You can tell I'm crazy about him. But my husband, he's a European diplomat. So at some point, we have to move. So to work at a place that was global, that was going to give me the opportunity to move around, made a lot of sense. So at any rate, I'm at a PR firm. I really like it. And it's flexible enough that they let me fly off to Kansas to come talk to you guys.
And we thank them for their generosity.
Yeah.
So I want to thank Caitlin. Caitlin, thank you for coming. This has been an awesome discussion. Next week is, and this is like where the part where your host has one tear rolling down his cheek, is our last discussion group for this Trump's first 100 days. But we're going to have a great session. I'll be rejoined by another beautiful, talented woman. My wife will be here next week. So Johanna and I are going to be joined by a fellow Jayhawk, Marlon Marshall, and we're going to discuss something that I think is an interesting component of Donald Trump's first 100 days, which is how Democrats and how people who are not in power react to a new presidency and what types of things they do to stay relevant or not. And we'll talk a lot about what kind of effect that's had on Democrats. With that, thank you guys so much, and we'll see you next week.
Thanks.